Okay, so this will be presentation about frequency hopping for SDR-based GSM mobile station. And frequency hopping is a topic that is still a bit of scary for some people. I tried to approach it and I will share my experiences with you. So first, very short introduction what frequency hopping is. So it's sequential change of frequencies on the radio link. And the presentation will be particularly about slow variant of frequency hopping. And it means in this that more than one of consecutive symbols is transmitted on the same frequency. And the slow frequency hopping together with some proper channel coding is a mitigation for fading due to multipath propagation. So for example, on one frequency, you can get signal loss due to destructive interference of different waves traveling through different paths. And if you would have only one frequency, then you would lose the signal completely, the connection completely. So here, if you have multiple frequencies on some of them, you might still get good reception for that particular location of mobile station, and this way you can keep connection. And the, in similar way, it's also mitigation for interferences that differ across different radio channels that are available, because signal to noise ratio can decrease on some radio channel, on other channels it might be better. And frequency hopping in GSM, from point of view of mobile station, it's one change of frequency per TDMA frame. And the hopping sequence generation is described in in 5.2 GPP spec, and the terminology that is used in there is that there is mobile allocation. It's set of radio channels that are allocating for different for particular connection. There is hopping sequence generator number. There is also mobile allocation index offset that is equivalent of channel for in case of hopping transmission. So one connection get one mobile allocation index offset, another one gets get different one. So this mobile allocation index offset and hopping sequence number together with frame number are used to generate mobile allocation index that is used to select frequency from mobile allocation set. And this is the algorithm. We're written in C. I won't go through all of this, but what is important is that for hopping sequence number zero, there is simple hopping based on frame number. So for in consecutive frame numbers, you will just get next frequencies from mobile allocation. And after the last frequency, you will go from the beginning. And in case of different hopping sequences, hopping sequence generator numbers, you get here a random number that is generated with this sophisticated algorithm based on frame number and some random number errand table that is not here. So you will get in the result some randomized sequences of frequencies. And I splitted different options of implementation of frequency hopping based on the way it is implemented into following categories. And there is hopping in analog domain. This is retuning of some analog radio equipment, radio front end. There is hopping in digital domain. You can retune some digital waveform generator. There you can channelize whole baseband. You can also use multiple transmitters, receivers. Don't retune them, just tune to the frequencies. So you can cover all of the frequencies that are interesting. And for hopping in analog domain, it's basically retuning of local oscillators on analog front end. The big advantage is that you don't have any additional computations on PC or inside of SDR device, but it requires local oscillators with fast retuning capability and with and the SDR itself must be able to switch frequencies at precisely defined moments. So if you, in your particular SDR you don't have these things, then you are out of luck and no analog-based hopping for you. And you can also do hopping in digital domain. On the PC side, variation, it's the big advantage is that you can get arbitrarily quick retune time. You can get no retune time at all, but it requires a lot of computations of on the PC because you have to process full available baseband, and the available baseband is also limited by throughput of connection between SDR and PC. Then you can do digital hopping on SDR side, so you can get also very quick retunes, but limited by particular algorithm that is implemented in the FPGA. So if you don't want to implement yourself another one. And the big advantage is that there is no computation on the additional computations on the PC side, but it requires also a lot of bandwidth from SDR device. For modern devices, it's not that big problem. For example, for X310, user PU gets maximum 160 megahertz, and it's enough to cover GSM 900 and GSM 1800 bands. For B210, the maximum bandwidth is 56 megahertz, and it's enough to cover full GSM 900 and most of GSM 1800 bands. And shortly, channelization of whole baseband. There are fast algorithms to perform this, for example, polyphase channelizers and synthesizers. There are implementations for PC side. For example, in GNU Radio, there is channelizers or synthesizer block. There are some RF network on chip blocks for USRP's X300 series also. But it also requires a lot of computations, and computations that are completely unnecessary from mobile station point of view. They might be interesting from base station point of view, but here mobile station doesn't need all of the channels at the same time, just usually one. So I would rather not use this approach. Then you can also have approach me with multiple transmitters and receivers used to cover full mobile allocation, so you don't have to retune any local oscillators, but it increases costs, and there is additional burden to synchronize all of the SDR devices. Preferably, the SDR equipment should be cheap, like RTL SDR devices or FL2K for transmitting. And for RTL SDRs, I did something for synchronizing them. It's called multi-RTL. And there is GNU Radio block for this, so they tune to some frequency, common frequency, multiple RTL SDRs that are synchronized in frequency are connecting, are tuning to the same frequency. Synchronization is performed, and then they are switching to target frequencies that can be different, and they stay synchronized. But for FL2K, I don't know of any such implementation yet, and I wouldn't want to do synchronization of all of this stuff before doing any actual hopping. So I would rather also not use this approach. Okay. So I did some tests of hopping, and the first one was 11 years ago. So it's actually ancient history. I did some implementation of switching frequency in 8051 compatible chip that was on USRP1. And on timer interrupt, there was switching of frequency was performed to some GSM channel and some empty channel. So here you can see the transition period, and it's about half of TDMA frame. And it could be used, therefore, for mobile station hopping, but the daughter board that was used there is not sold by Etus anymore. It's just for historical record here. And for modern modern SDR hardware, I performed different tests. They were generating sine wave on transmit port. The transmit port was connected back through 30 dB attenuator, like in here, through a loop back to the Eric's port. And with use of timed commands in UHD USRP hardware driver, frequencies of local oscillator or DSP frequencies were switched with period of 50 milliseconds. The expected output was is in this case frequency with constant frequencies sine wave, but probably with transition periods when frequencies change. And these are test results for X310 for with UBX160 daughter board, and this is only for frequencies from GSM 900 band, so don't get too attached to this result. This is warning. So I plotted the transition period for many hops on the same plot, and you can see that changes start synchronously, and they last about 80 microseconds, something under 100 microseconds. But I can tell you that for sure it's not true in general case. For example, there is if you go through 100, if you go through 1.5 gigahertz, the change will be very slow. Like I don't remember exactly. I did some tests, but it's tens of milliseconds slow. So you cannot do fast tuning from GSM 900 to GSM 1800 bands this way.
What was the
daughter command you used? UBX 160. Etus mailing list say there is something like 500 microseconds of switching time, but it really varies depending on where you hop. where you change, over which frequencies you change. And this is a test for B210, and I plotted a different figure here. And this white, you get in rows amplitude of signal for each hop. So these white strips in here are transition periods. One, if you consider only one, it's maybe not that long, but considering that they are not synchronous according to any point, they are spread over so wide time, so you cannot rely on this to do analog hopping. So this is not good because B210 is our primary target, so maybe something else can save us, and this something else is digital hopping on SDR side. And this is the same plot as for X310, but this time you have even shorter transition time. It's not zero, but we don't need zero. For this particular sample frequency that was used, it's about 15 microseconds, so even if it will be a few times longer, it's still good. So this is method that was used. And as for implementation of hopping, as I said, UHD provides timed commands API that lets you control different settings of USRPs, and, for example, lets you control frequencies in very precisely defined moments. And as we are using GNU Radio for implementation of the transceiver, the very useful fact is that there is support for these timed commands exposed in GNU Radio through takes commands stream tag API that is exposed in UHD sync. You can send stream tags to the input that have key TX command, and you can switch frequencies this way. You can also use command inputs in the USRP sync and source blocks, and send messages that will control the frequencies through this way. As for stream tags, they seem at first to be very convenient because you can just attach frequencies that you want to use for transmit and receive side to the transmitted burst. But what with situations where there is nothing to transmit and you still want to receive something, so you won't be able to switch frequency in this situation. And so we decided to use messages, and one best message can be used to control both transmit and receive frequencies. But in mainline GNU Radio, it cannot do it simultaneously, so I extended GNU Radio so it is possible, but it's not in mainline yet, as of now. And the implementation is based on addition of GNU Radio block that does frequency hopping. It tracks current USRP time and generates with some advanced frequency change commands to USRP source. And the format of this message is here. I'm putting it here because it wasn't very straightforward to find out this format and even example in GNU Radio got it wrong. And this was flow graph that was used for the tests that I've shown. So there is some sine wave generator in GNU Radio and output to USRP sync, and here is hopping on Ericsson TX site. done by frequency hopper. So for testing of frequency hopping implementation, I decided to use a recording of a call with frequency hopping that I had. Here is, for the record, description. Most important part is this mobile allocation and hopping sequence number zero. So there is simple hopping done in this case. And this is overview of this recording after channelization. If you look at it, not much can be seen, but I highlighted the frequencies from mobile allocation. So here you can see a little point that something is transmitted, then on next frequency in next frame, then in next frame on this frequency, and then so on. So I selected only these channels from mobile allocation, and here you got whole frames, and after zooming in even further to only time slot zero, you get something like this. So I can do the hopping of this in octave, and I did it to assemble the signal with following amplitude. So all of the interesting frames in one signal. And now, can we play audio from this recording? Just for testing if it's a good test signal. Okay, I can do it again. Okay, so this is some automatic response that voicemail is full and doesn't accept any new messages. And so the signal is good for test. Now, can we do the same as I did in octave, but this time with use of USRP? And in this case, wideband signal that I recorded previously was played again to USRP and received back by doing only receive side hopping, dehopping. And on this side, there is this, here there is a part for decoding and playing the sound of this recording. So this is missing in here. And now I will try to use ESRP this time to play, to do the hopping, and let's check if it will work. Okay, it works. There are some clicks, but yeah. Or overflow, I don't know. And yeah, so it works, it's great. On the receive side, we've got working hopping with use of USRP B210. And now, can we do the same on transmit side? So this time, there is also transmit side hopping being done. And now, a signal after the hopping is played. So this is now narrowband signal. And if I run this this flow graph, let's check how it will work. Yeah, and there are even some decoded control messages from traffic channel printed here. Okay, so yeah, so frequency hopping definitely works. And now, what is left to do? So we have to somehow connect messages with hopping parameters from upper layers that will configure the hopping block. We need some way to automatically synchronize frame numbers and USRP time. And for this, also, what is important is synchronization synchronization of sample frequency with BTS. And for some devices, it, like Lime SDRs or XTRX or USRP's B200 Mini, it might be easier because VCXO is tunable with use of a DAC. So you can tune it so the frequency of VCO is closely synchronized with base station, and you can treat your USRP as source of time. But for other USRPs and other SDRs, correction has to be done in software, and at the moment it's a bit still a bit painful. I've got ideas how to do it. I got some half-baked implementation and some difficulties are, for example, translating some events that are happening, like frequency change moments to USRP time, from because it's not synchronized with frame clock, so you have to do conversions. Another additional difficulty added by GNU Radio itself is that stream tags are not stream tags position is not handled correctly by GNU Radio when resample rate changes, and we have to use resampler to change the sample frequency, and so this hurts. I implemented a resampler that does tag propagation right, but there are still some pieces that need to be implemented. So this is the end. I only want to say that the work is sponsored by NLNet Foundation. This is a small foundation that that funds projects, open source projects that have that extends use, for example, user privacy for private communication, for open standards and things like that. You can check on the web page of NLNet Foundation, and the next deadline for submitting ideas is 1st June. So there only short proposal is needed. If you have something in mind, feel free to submit it. So this is all. Thank you.
So could you explain a bit more how all the frequency hopping is specified on the specs? Let's say, so like how do you configure it? Like how many ARFCNs, or if they need to be one to each other, so the limitations or...
You mean if they have to be somehow consecutive or anything like
that? Yeah, or like how many of them can you use or this kind of...
Maximally 64. I don't know any other limitation, and probably in practice also in one, they should be in one band, but I'm not 100%. Yeah, it's Harald says it has to be, so it's true.
Did you look at using the B210 fast hopping feature?
I look at the data sheet, but nothing other than that. So I tried to use what is available from Etus, and didn't go into that yet.
Okay. Well, if you at some point you want to look at it, just ask me, because I looked at it and implemented fast hopping already, and you can definitely get switching times under one time slot.
So it's better than what was on that slide. And you can get it synchronized, yeah?
Yes, it's basically. But I mean, you need a custom FPGA image and some custom code and stuff like that. But I'm not sure how. The general idea is that to save the because by default B210 doesn't support time command at all, at least for the ADI.
Yeah.
That's why you get random stuff. It only supports time command to the
this
FPGA.
This is some limitation of the chip itself.
Yeah. So I mean, it's a limitation of how they implemented the FPGA because the tuning algorithm they use for the ADI has a lot of back and forth between the host and the...
Okay, so everything goes through the host, and this is the reason for this variation.
Yeah, but what you can do with a fast tuning is that you kind of pre-configure all the... you tune the FPGA to frequency 1, you read all the registers, or the calibration register, you tune it to frequency 2, you read all the registers, you do that for all the frequency you're predicting you're going to need to tune to, and then you can tell the ADI to...
There's no limit on the number of...
In hardware, it can do 8... But if you want more than that, what you do is that while you're using register set 1, from the host you load register set 2 in advance, and then you use a timed command to switch to register set 2 when you're ready.
Okay, so you need just 2 of them.
To do a ping pong kind of thing.
So the first time you played your manually decoded wideband capture.
Yeah,
and then the second time, was live decoding by the components.
This was transmitted on USRP, the same USRP. So I had at least perfect synchronization. I didn't have to do it myself, but yeah, it was done with use of RF hardware.
Yeah, but what I was sort of wondering, where is the signaling for the frequency hopping in that
there is no, it's everything is at this moment done by hand.
Okay.
So the synchronization I can show you here, there is some skip heads just skipping some number of samples, so the receiver gets first time slot on known position. And yeah, there is no synchronization yet. Synchronization itself is not time synchronization is not that hard, but keeping it over time it's more tricky.
Okay.
I would like to do two questions. For the MS, if this code could run in a normal baseband GSM chip, if the chip would be capable, I don't know, Calypso or any chipset.
Mm-hmm.
And as I see, the frequency hop is made in a deterministic way, and the purpose is to improve the RF performance of the terminal.
Yeah,
right?
There are some people that still claim that it has some impact on the security.
This is what I would like to ask.
Snooping, but it's not true.
Yeah, it's deterministic. But this could be changed, right? You could have a key that only the two parties, let's say the BTS and the mobile station, have, and then the frequency hopping would not be known by someone sniffing the channel.
Yeah,
so you could use for security,
like
just like military radio, this frequency hopping. You don't know which frequency you go to unless you have the key. This could be easy to adapt your code to do some known...
One issue with... I mean, if you do point-to-point, it's easy, but that's a problem with
An issue with a randomized algorithm like that is to guarantee there is no collisions between two MS talking. The algorithm that they came up with guarantees that, of course, all the allocation will... You don't lose any capacity and there is no collision ever, despite the random nature... if you use a cryptographic key trying to ensure that two MS never conflict and talk at the same time on the same frequency, that's going to be a little harder to...
The cost would be some capacity.
Yeah.
Because you would have to preserve...
I'm thinking from other point of view, maybe... if you use this kind of approach also in a more or less crowded spectrum without a license, this could also make your calls work, even if some frames get lost because
depends because GSM channel coding was designed for some particular threads that are you can find in GSM link and probably some other users transmitting on the same frequencies might not be one of them, at least not some powerful transmissions that can jam your transmission. So I just don't know. Maybe it could work.
Do you think this can run in a normal baseband GSM chip?
Normal phones always use child support frequency hopping according to the specification.
It already supports.
Yeah, it's mandatory.
Ah, okay, thanks.
The problem that it basically works inside baseband.
Yes, with SDR things are a bit more complex than with some highly optimized for GSM baseband.
Yeah, so in the phone you have the RF chip directly next to the baseband processor, and you in the Calypso you have this TPU, the time processing unit, where you can basically issue commands to the RF, like on a digital level, serial commands in parallel, GPIO toggling synchronous to the GSM frame clock. So you have this very direct link to control the RF chip, and the RF chip is of course designed for GSM, so it will have the fast retuning capability that is required. So that's why it's so easy in a phone, in quotes, compared to an SDR.
There is also a neighbor measurement task, right. And you have to switch even faster. Like in case of frequency hopping, you have a single TDMA frame to switch the frequency. But in case of neighbor measurement, you only have like three time slots to switch to some particular ARFC and measure the power quickly, probably try to decode synchronization bursts and go back. That's the point. And probably you can also do this neighbor measurement during the frequency hopping. So that's a huge sequence of changing frequencies here.
Yeah, also if you take a look at those, or try to, these GPRS and specs, and that even gets even more complicated in terms of what the phone has to do in terms of retuning, and then not only that, but also processing what it's seen on other frequencies and then get back in time to get back to where it's supposed to be and do what it's supposed to do, then it's really quite impressive.
The GPRS is kind of TDMA inside TDMA.
Okay. So thank you for your attention.